Hey everyone, a very good morning to all of you. So myself Neha Gupta, your mentor for current affairs, and today's video, my friends, I'm going to tell you that it is really, really very interesting. क्या आप लोगों ने कभी सुना है कि पूरी की पूरी एक एम्बेसी ऑनलाइन प्लेटफॉर्म पे है? हैव यू एवर हर्ड ऑफ अ वर्चुअल एम्बेसी कंप्लीटली नो ब्रिक एंड मोर्टर एग्जिस्टेंस ऑफ एन एम्बेसी ऑफ अ कंट्री? यस. सो दिस इज वन ऑफ द टॉपिक्स दैट वी आर गोइंग टू डिस्कस इन दिस वीडियो. उससे भी ऊपर जो आज तक कभी नहीं हुआ, दैट इज समथिंग दैट वी आर गोइंग टू डिस्कस. यस, इंडियाज population is going to decline. This is something, or we can say that we have reached the stage of population stabilization. Yes, so now population would at least not be a burden on India. So these are some of the topics out of the many topics that I have picked for today's session. Therefore, in the beginning only, I'm declaring that this session is not going to be a very boring or mundane session. This is a really, really interesting session. So let's join me with the questions. But before that, if you want the PDF of this session, then you can join the Telegram channel, and the link of that Telegram channel is in description below. So let's discuss the very first question. So this is about the sex ratio that has come out from the NFHS 5. So first of all, let me tell you the brief about it. So NFHS, National Family Health Survey, fifth edition of that survey, was conducted in two phases. First phase was conducted in 2020, and the report of that was released in December last year only, wherein 22 states and UTs were assessed. Right now, the phase 2 of NFHS has come out, and the results are from the 14 remaining states and union territories. So as per the report, the holistic report I'm talking about, both the phase 1 and phase 2. So as per the holistic report, the sex ratio of India has increased. So this is again a historic thing that we have more women than men. So the ratio is 1020. So overall, the outlook of the NFHS, the results that NFHS 5 has presented are very positive. They have the results have shown a very positive trend, be it the malnutrition status, be it your sex ratio, be it your population stabilization. So we are going to discuss about all of that. So let's jump into that thing and discuss that. So the very first thing is that, yes, the total fertility rate of India has declined, and it has reached 2 at the national level. So earlier it was 2.2 in 2015 to 2016, and now when this survey was conducted, so period, the time period which is taken into consideration during the NFHS 5 is 2019 to 2021. So during this duration, we have found that the total fertility rate of India is 2. Now, what is total fertility rate? That means the children per woman. How many children is a woman giving birth to? So that is the total fertility rate. So this amounts to 2 children per woman. Now, the ideal TRF is 2.1. Do remember this point. Ideal TRF, ideal total fertility rate, it's TFR, okay, not TRF, it's TFR. TFR ratio is 2.1, and India, the national average of India is 2.0. That shows that we have reached a population stabilization stage. Now, does this mean that we are going to face the decline in our population in the near future? No. But yes, after 35 to 40 years, we can expect a nominal decline in our young population, because the total fertility rate, ideal, is 2.1, and we are below that ideal fertility rate. Okay, so it's 2 right now. But that indicates the population stabilization stage that we needed to achieve at this point of time. Now, this means that we will not have to face the burden on our resources because of the population. And this also indicates that we can very well keep our focus on environmental sustainability, because right now we have a stable population. We have reached that stage. wherein the resources that we can produce or that we can have should be able to fulfill the demand of our population. Therefore, we can go towards sustainable development now. India will still become the most populous country in the world. It was expected somewhere between 2024 to 2028, but now it will be delayed. Time period we have already discussed. Okay, so we have talked about the total fertility rate of the entire nation. So let's divide it into urban and rural areas. So urban areas 1.6, rural areas 2.1. The phase 2 has covered 14 states and UTs. Phase 1 covered 22 states and UTs. Now guys, here, these are the 7 states which we can say have the total fertility rate at 2 or above 2. So these are the 5 states that have more than the national average, that have the TFR which is higher than the national average, which is 2. Okay, so the highest is in Bihar. Then we have Meghalaya 2.9, Uttar Pradesh 2.4, Jharkhand 2.3, Manipur 2.2. Okay, now guys, you need to memorize the TFRs of all the top 5 highly populated states, because this can become a question directly in your examination, that what is the TFR of Meghalaya, because this is a northeastern state and we all know that northeast development is one of the agendas of the government. So how the government is trying to tackle this problem of high fertility rate, or is there actually a problem of high fertility rate in the northeast state of Meghalaya and Manipur? Okay, similar questions can also be made from the other states. Okay, so you have to memorize the TFRs of all these top 5 states. Then we have 2 states which have the TFR equal to the national average, that is 2, Madhya Pradesh and Rajasthan. Now here is the list of the states that have a TFR lower than the national average. So you can see 1.9, 1.8, 1.7, 1.6. Now here, pay attention to this thing, that you don't have to memorize this entire list, but yes, if you are a citizen of any of these states, then you should be aware of the TFR of your own state, because it will be asked, or it might be asked in your interview also. Okay, so that's the basic understanding that you should have. So apne state ka zarur yaad kar lena, and remember the TFR of these 7 states. These are important from exam point of view, and this is important for your interview point of view or general understanding of your current affairs. Okay, now what are the reasons why the fertility rate is declining, or it has achieved the stabilization stage at this point of time, we can say. So the first reason is contraceptive prevalence rate. So the usage of contraceptive techniques has increased. Next is decline in the unmet needs of family planning. Okay, so the people are getting aware about the importance of family planning, about the usage of contraceptive, full immunization in kids aged 12 to 23 months. It has also increased. Then we have institutional births, which has also increased. Then we have stunting. So stunting has shown a marginal decline here, which is a very good improvement on the part of the state, basically India. But still the improvement is very marginal when it comes to infant and child mortality rate. So let's have a look at this neonatal mortality rate. Let me first tell you that all of these 3 rates have shown improvement from the previous NFHS 4. Okay, so all of these rates have declined. Neonatal mortality rate stands at 24.9, infant mortality rate stands at 35.2, under 5 mortality rate stands at 41.9. Then we have child nutrition. Stunting stands at 36%, wasting 19%, underweight 36%. Again, all of these have shown an improvement. However marginal it is, but improvement is improvement. So improvement is there. We still need to do a lot of work in these fields in order to reduce the mortality and reduce the malnutrition among children. But do remember that overall the outlook of NFHS 5th was very positive. However, is it sustainable? Is this positive outlook sustainable or authentic? That is something we can ask ourselves. Okay, this is another point of importance, that is the sex ratio. ठीक है, 1020, this is for the first time that women have this sex ratio is skewed in the favor of women. There are more women than men. So do remember this sex ratio as well. Now, I want to show you something, guys. This is basically the PDF of the NFHS 5. So, I basically want to show you the different indicators that are there. So, these are the key indicators. First is population and household profile, characteristics of adults, then you have the marriage and fertility, and these are the rates, urban, rural, total, then the comparison with the 20. The last one, the NFHS 4, which was conducted in 2015 to 16. So this is the comparison that they have drawn, and these are the numbers, these are the indicators. So there are many indicators. Now look at this thing. Neonatal mortality rate, it has declined from 29.5% in the last survey round to 24.9%. Then this, we have infant mortality, it has also declined from 40 to 35.2%. Then we have under 5 mortality rate, it has also declined. Now the point of showing you this PDF is that there are many indicators, and in my perspective, the indicators which were important from your phase one perspective, I have picked up those indicators only. Okay, for example, you have all these indicators here. So I did not pick all of them because in my opinion, in phase one, they do not go in so much depth. But yes, guys, if you want to prepare for the phase two of your ESI, then you should be thorough with this NFHS 5, and for that you have to wait for the Manish sir session, which he is going to definitely take for you all on this NFHS only. Now from the phase one perspective, I have already taught you the important and relevant points. Now let's get back to our PDF. Okay, so here we have the next question. Which state has signed an MOU with the Save Life Foundation to create zero mortality corridors in the state for reducing accident deaths? So here, guys, the right answer is Odisha. The government of Odisha has signed this MOU with this Delhi-based NGO, and both of these organizations, basically the government of Odisha and this NGO, both of them are going to create the zero fatality corridors. They are basically the roads which are safe and where the fatalities of road accident will be reduced. Okay, so work to reduce that fatality will be done on certain areas in the state of Odisha with the help of this Save Life Foundation. That is the basic purpose of this MOU. Next question is, what is the name of the exercise recently conducted by the Indian Navy for preparing maritime stakeholders for contingencies? So out of these options, the right answer is Prasthan. Okay, so Indian Navy conducted this exercise off the coast of Mumbai in order to tackle the contingency. Basically, the basic purpose of this Prasthan exercise was to empower the stakeholders. Which stakeholders are we talking about? The stakeholders like Coast Guard, the stakeholders like ONGC. ONGC is a major, we can say, stakeholder because it has many plants, it has many works offshore. Then we have Air Force, then we have Port Trust, State Fisheries Department, Marine Police. So all of these are the stakeholders. So in order to empower these stakeholders to tackle the contingencies, this exercise was undertaken by the Indian Navy. Okay, do pay attention that the Western Naval Command undertook this exercise. Okay, so it was at the helm. Next is, which of the following countries conduct Dosti exercise with India? Sri Lanka, Maldives, Bangladesh, Myanmar, Thailand, Philippines, Indonesia, Singapore, Japan, and Philippines. Which countries conduct this Dosti exercise with India? So it is the Indian Ocean neighbors of ours, Sri Lanka and Maldives. Okay, so do remember, it was the 15th edition of this exercise that took place in Mali. Maldives, which is the capital of Maldives. Mali is the capital. And do remember that it is a biennial Coast Guard exercise. Okay, so this can also become a question. Coast Guard की exercise है, biennial है, and this was the 15th edition, and we have completed 30 years since the inception of this exercise. Okay, so that was another point of importance. What is the name of the exercise recently conducted by Indian Army, Indian Navy, Indian Air Force, Indian Coast Guard, Border Security Force, Gujarat Police, and the Marine Police in Kutch Peninsula to test the combat readiness of the agencies in real-time scenario? So again, this was one of the preparatory exercises that was conducted by all the armed forces of India. So what is the right answer here? The right answer is Sagar Shakti. Okay, it was organized by the Indian Army's Southern Command. Apart from this, there is nothing else to memorize in this exercise. Do remember the venue, Kutch Peninsula. Which is the first country in the world to open its embassy on metaverse? So here the answer is Barbados. So this is the first country that has opened its own embassy, completely virtual embassy on metaverse. Metaverse, you would all know that it is the virtual platform of Facebook. Okay, so first of all, El Salvador is one country. It is important from the options because it is the first country that legalized Bitcoin as its currency. Barbados was in the news because recently it elected its first president, and the name of that president is your question. Mention it in the comment section. As far as this news is concerned, so for creating this embassy, they have partnered with Decentraland, which is a blockchain metaverse platform, to establish this digital platform, to establish their own embassy on this metaverse digital platform. Now, guys, this is the location of Barbados, okay? Between USA and sorry, between North America and South America, we have the Caribbean islands, and as in the Caribbean islands, Barbados is a part, okay? So you can see Cuba here, then we have Barbados, and this is the these are the other islands. Basically, this portion is the South America, not the islands, okay? Next question is, recently, Network International, an enabler of digital commerce across the Middle East and Africa, has signed an MOU with NPCI International Payments Limited to explore the implementation of the Unified Payments Interface in the Dash Nation. So here the right answer is UAE. Okay. Before moving into the details of this news, I would like to ask a question from you all, and that question is that when was this NPCI International Payment Limited formed by NPCI? This is again a very recent agency that has been formed, so you have to tell me the year in which this organization was formed. So there is nothing much in this news. Basically, the Network International aims to implement the services of UPI in UAE also, and for that it has partnered with NIPL, that is NPCI International Payment Limited. Okay, so right now they are basically exploring this idea of implementing the UPI system in the country. They have not implemented yet. Okay, next point, which is of importance and can become a question, is the volume of UPI transactions. So basically, here we have the value of UPI transactions. So in 2020, the UPI transactions that India had were worth 15% of the total GDP of India. So this is a very huge quantum of transactions that that the citizens of India did in 2020 by using UPI. So this is important. This can become a question in your exam. So guys, here this session ends. I hope that you have liked this session and enjoyed it as well. Thank you so much for watching it. And if you have really liked the content, then do not forget to subscribe our channel and like this video as well. Thank you.